If there's one thing we can say with absolute certainty about the labour movement of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, is that by and large it was created in direct response to the overwhelming power and unmitigated brutality of the capitalist class at the time. So what you like about today's socialists and union rights activists, many of whom, it must be said, do spend way too much time online, but it's undeniable that much of the work done by the unions today is largely a continuation of the legacy of the necessary and important work carried out by the union activists of yesterday. People will often, nowadays, point to examples of unions in the 80s, arguably at the height of their power, making apparently unreasonable demands or grinding society to a standstill in order to demand more and more concessions, usually as a holdover from Thatcherite propaganda regarding the miners' unions and so on. And I do definitely want to touch on that particular part of working class history at a later date, but today I want to talk about the very real conflict between workers and bosses at the height of the Western labour movement in the early 20th century, and the conditions that made what we now view as the labour movement possible, and even necessary, because regardless of your feelings about modern unions, which, again, many if not most people have been misinformed on, it cannot be denied that what they represent and what they've done for the average worker is huge. Likewise, we have to discuss the massive levels of violence and brutality enacted by the bosses against those simply asking for decent living and working conditions, because when people, especially people on the right, and that goes double for libertarians and ANCAPs, pretend that capitalism without regulation is in any way a moral or defensible position to take, we need to be able to point to what happened the last time we as a society tried that, at least in the West.
People think we live in a capitalist society, and that capitalism has gone wrong. We don't live in a capitalist society. We live in a crony capitalist society, in which people get on not because of the risks they take or the talent they show, but by milking the system, by the special relationships they enjoy with those in power, by the laws, the licenses, the regulations, the protection, and the subsidies granted in their favour. Libertarians preach tolerance. We tolerate others' views, we tolerate their speech, we tolerate their behaviour. But there is one thing we do not tolerate, and that is crony capitalism.
Before we begin, I should probably point out that this video is mostly going to be summary and context, and primarily exists so that I can refer to it and not have to repeat myself in future videos. If you like, you can probably skip it if you're willing to just accept that due to the overwhelming power of the profit motive and the capitalist class, life for the average working person was hard and often torturous, and also the capitalists and bosses would frequently engage in incredible amounts of violence against workers who dared to stand up to them. We'll be covering a lot of these issues and specific examples in much more detail in future videos. However, for anyone unfamiliar with labour history or who perhaps may benefit from the extra context, I've made this video to give you a very brief overview of the context of the labour movement in both Europe and the US before we get into specifics in future videos. This video is split into two main sections: working life and conditions at the turn of the 20th century and examples of anti-union violence. Right, let's get into it, shall we?
When the union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no power greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet what force on earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one? But the union makes us strong. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever.
There's an old saying when it comes to discussions around health and safety regulations that these sometimes obvious sounding and common sense laws we have to follow in the workplace are written in blood, and in many ways that's undeniably true. I don't necessarily want to go into a huge discussion of what rights the unions won for us over the years, because that's a topic for an upcoming video I'm working on, but just to give you an idea here, I'll briefly touch on some of the things workers had to deal with in order to survive at the turn of the 20th century that made the labour movement so necessary and attractive to so many people. After urban capitalism began to replace the more rural feudal societies of the Middle Ages, and more working people were forced to flock to the cities and big industrial centres in order to survive, basically, or at least to continue to provide for their families, and the Industrial Revolution enabled most human labour to be focused more around commodity production than farming and food production, the simple life of the serf or peasant was left behind in favour of the life of the city-living factory worker. Now, we could debate the benefits of each of these lifestyles for hours, and I'm not necessarily saying that feudalism was preferable, but it needs to be acknowledged that as the power of the aristocracy waned, the exploitative power of the industrialist and capitalist class that rose to replace it was not quite the freedom those peasants who revolted a few hundred years earlier had hoped. The power the lords held over the people was not gone, merely redirected to another class of people who were just as happy to exploit and abuse them. During the 19th century, things did improve, of course, and we even worked out that maybe having human shit in our water supply maybe wasn't the best of ideas, so that's definitely a positive step. However, the state of workers' rights was still pretty dire, and as the enormous wealth gap increased, the life of the average worker began to seem a lot more disposable. Things reached breaking point and people started to fight back, even in the face of brutal violence coming from the capitalist classes. But what kind of life would a worker have had to endure that would push them to risk their lives in this way? Well, let's just go through a few dates at which certain rights were granted and ruminate on perhaps what this may have meant for workers prior to these rights being granted, shall we? The first group of workers to achieve the 8-hour day in the UK were the Beckton gas workers, after strike action was initiated on the 31st of March 1889 in response to the introduction of compulsory 18-hour shifts. The UK has still not implemented legislation forcing this to happen across the board, however, and the maximum working time directive, which you can opt out of if you want, I guess, caps it at 48 hours a week. The Workmen's Compensation Act of 1906 gave workers the right to compensation for injury incurred on the job. Old age pensions were introduced for over 70s in 1908. The right to first aid in mines was implemented in 1910 with the Mines Accident Rescue and Aid Act. The 1911 National Insurance Act kicked off the precursor to the modern NHS, which is definitely a topic for a future video, but importantly, it also introduced sick pay. The first real regulations on the smelting of lead and other related substances were passed in 1911, prohibiting the employment of women and children in these processes and ordered monthly medical examinations of all employees. It wasn't until the ratification of the Children and Young Persons Act 1933 that child labour was officially regulated in the UK. So just bear all that in mind when we're talking about workers' rights at the turn of the 20th century. This is all happening in the context of working class people having to work 18-hour shifts. Many of their children will be working in factories from a young age in order to help feed their families. They'd be unable to retire and therefore would literally be working until they died. Any injuries incurred in these often hazardous places would be ineligible for compensation, and you wouldn't even have a right to medical attention even if you were getting lead poisoning every day, and even after all these reforms, there were still massive loopholes and caveats baked in. The 1933 Child Labour and Young Persons Act, for example, only covered children under the age of 14, and the old age pensions provided at the beginning were extremely low and nowhere near a level when one could realistically live a decent life, but they were the first steps, and many were forced by Labour activists, either through strike action forcing legislators' hands, or simply by more radical political groups like the British Labour Party, forcing the Liberal Party to accept more sweeping reforms in order to guarantee support in Parliament. The examples I've just given are mostly Britain-centric, but the case is very much the same in the US and throughout Europe, with a couple of minor differences in timings and broadness of these reforms. We remember these victories because they were successful, but we tend to gloss over, or simply forget, the sacrifices and brutality that had to be endured in order to get there. So, about that.
When the Union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no power greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet what force on earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one? But the Union makes us strong. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever, for the Union makes us strong.
This status quo was important, and in many ways essential to the people with the power and wealth at this time to maintain, and often their methods of doing so were really rather extreme and ended up with pretty terrifying displays of casual violence and unnecessary cruelty enacted upon those who dared challenge it, who dared to start using their collective power to demand and fight for better wages, greater rights, and more humane conditions. This wasn't particularly uncommon or only occurring under extreme circumstances either. In some places, workers who were agitating or attempting to form or organize union efforts would be literally lynched by thugs in the employ of the bosses, a phenomenon that was sadly immortalized in Woody Guthrie's Union Burying Ground.
I see there a lowering, a rotten new coffin. I see there letting down a rotten new coffin. Way over in that Union Burying Ground.
I'm going to go over a few examples here, very briefly, because I want to cover each of these in a significant amount of detail in their own videos in future, but I think it's important to briefly give examples of what I mean, so if there's anything I mentioned that you'd like to hear more about in future, let me know, because in all likelihood, they will be getting their own long deep dive sooner or later. In the inverse to the above section, most of these examples will be American, because I know that a lot of my audience are Americans. Now, this section is further separated into two categories I want to use to demonstrate both the broad and vast power and massive extraordinary lengths to which capitalists would often resort and be able to enact upon striking workers or union members, and then also get more specific and tell the stories of individual martyrs whose stories it's equally important to tell and to remember.
Oh, tell me who's that they're letting down, down. Tell me who's that they're letting down, down. Way over in that Union Burying Ground. Another union organizer. Another union organizer. Way over in that Union Burying Ground.
It's a strange thing to think, but during this time period, the bosses had both the government and, in large part, the National Guard, military, and their own army of thugs, such as the Pinkertons, who we'll definitely be talking about again in future, in their pockets, ready and willing at any moment to drop everything and enforce their will, which, when it came to striking workers, often meant enormous military retribution for daring to exert the power of labour over their bosses, as was the case during the Tony Pandy riots of 1910, in which the British government, specifically the Home Office, which at the time was under the leadership of a young Winston Churchill, authorised sending in troops to crush the strike with pretty extreme brutality. Oh, wait, sorry, did I say it was strange to us in the modern day? I guess I must have forgotten the Standing Rock oil pipeline protests, in which a group of primarily Native American protesters attempted to stop an oil pipeline being built across their sacred land and were brutally suppressed by law enforcement and private military contractors who treated them like enemy combatants in a war zone rather than people trying to protect their ancestral homeland. My mistake.
I'm a union buster, the bosses trust the aim. I help keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
He's a union buster, the bosses trust the aim. He helps keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
One of the most important and significant events in the early union movement was the Haymarket Affair, in which, on May 3rd, 1886, one person was killed and several injured as police intervened to protect strikebreakers and intimidate strikers during peaceful union action that formed part of a national campaign to secure an 8-hour workday in Chicago. In response to protest police brutality, anarchist labor leaders called a mass meeting the next day in Haymarket Square to show resistance and solidarity. Said gathering was reportedly peaceful, as attested by multiple eyewitnesses, including Chicago Mayor Carter Harrison. However, after most of the attendees departed, a contingent of police arrived and demanded that the crowd disperse. At that point, a bomb was thrown by an individual never positively identified, and police responded with random, indiscriminate gunfire into the crowd, kicking off a panicked riot. 7 police officers were killed and 60 others wounded before the violence ended. Civilian casualties have been estimated at 4 to 8 dead and 30 to 40 injured. The Haymarket Affair created widespread hysteria directed against immigrants and labor leaders. Amid the panic, August Spies and 7 other anarchists were convicted of murder on the grounds that they had conspired with or aided an unknown assailant. Many of the so-called Chicago 8, however, were not even present at the May 4th event, and their alleged involvement was never proven. Nevertheless, Spies and 3 other defendants were hanged on November 11th, 1887, and another defendant committed suicide.
I'm a union buster, the bosses trust the aim. I help keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
He's a union buster, the boss's trustee. He helps keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
In the autumn of 1913, around 10,000 miners, under the direction of the United Mine Workers of America, or UMWA, began a strike action lasting over 6 months, protesting low pay and poor working conditions in the coal fields of Colorado. In response, they were evicted from the company towns by the operators of John D. Rockefeller's Colorado Fuel and Iron Company, forcing the miners to construct enormous tent cities, the large of which housed around 1,200 strikers in Ludlow. The situation was really pretty tense, with the National Guard being brought in to help the company continue to operate, protecting strike breakers and ignoring blatant illegal violent actions taken by the company's representatives against the striking workers, including taking pot shots at them, causing some to dig a large basement-like hole for the pregnant women and small children to hide in for protection if it was deemed necessary. On Sunday, April 19th, 1914, the National Guard encircled the Ludlow camp and deployed a machine gun on a bluff overlooking the strikers. Although no one knows exactly what instigated the violence, though there are significant conflicting anecdotal accounts, the result was that the National Guard, at some point, for some reason, opened fire on the camp, initiating a full-on battle that lasted throughout the day. As the strikers, who were unable to resupply being surrounded, ran out of ammunition, they retreated from the camp into the surrounding countryside. Many women and children, hiding from the bullets that strafed the camp, huddled in the aforementioned cellars that had been dug underneath their tents in an attempt to avoid the gunfire. In the evening, apparently sick of having to actually shoot unarmed workers who wanted better working conditions, the National Guard troops soaked the tents in kerosene and set them on fire. Later, in one cellar, 11 children and 2 women were found burned alive and suffocated as a result. In all, 25 people were killed during the Ludlow Massacre, just 3 of whom were National Guard troops. In retaliation for the massacre, miners attacked ammunition town officials, strike breakers, and the mines, taking control of an area about 50 miles long and 5 miles wide, killing 50 people. And I want you to bear in mind that all of this, all of it, was extremely avoidable, and the only reason it happened in the first place was because it would have been expensive and inconvenient to improve workers' pay and conditions. And it was preferable in the minds of those in power to smash the strike and murder the strikers and their families rather than acquiescing to their really rather reasonable demands.
I'm a union buster, the bosses trust the aim. I help keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
He's a union buster, the bosses trust the aim. He helps keep their employees overworked and underpaid.
The November 5th, 1916 massacre was a culmination of tensions which had been brewing for 6 months in Everett, Washington. On May 1st, 1916, the Everett Shingle Weavers Union went on strike. The strike was settled quickly in favour of the mill owners at all but one mill, which is when the IWW, Radical and Extremely Effective Union, became involved, and this was like a spark to a powder keg. In 1916, the IWW was a relatively new organization with radical leftist beliefs, and had earned a reputation for causing trouble in order to achieve their aims and a resolution for their members. For example, a 1909 IWW strike in Spokane had cost the city over $250,000, a great deal of money back then. Famously at the time, and it remains to this same day, the first sentence in the IWW Constitution stated, "The working class and the employing class have nothing in common." Thus, when the IWW came to Everett, the establishment quickly became nervous. The IWW quickly started agitating, recruiting, and overall causing anxiety in the minds of the mill owners who'd until recently been under the impression that they'd all but won the strike. On August 19th, 1916, the atmosphere changed from essentially non-violent, if radical, agitating to something altogether more troubling, as the pent-up tensions erupted into violent. Earlier, at the Jomison Mill, the only mill left on strike, the strike breakers had beaten the picketers and the police refused to get involved, turning a blind eye on the grounds that the mill was on private property and crime stopped being illegal on private property or something. Later in this day, the picketers retaliated, but this time the police did intervene because, as we see to this day, the police primarily exist to protect the interests of capital. This inconsistency added fuel to the fire, as did the sheriff's office deciding that arrest alone did not serve as a significant deterrent to the IWW speakers and agitators, meaning that the police now began beating the speakers they arrested for good measure. They ran IWW members out of town and blocked entrance to the town merely for being members. The IWW began bringing members to town in groups, but the police, enlisting the aid of citizen deputies, beat the groups as well. This continued for some time until the IWW decided to organize a mass rally of 300 people on November the 5th, showing up in boats and singing union songs. In response, local business interests placed armed goon squads on the dock and on at least one tugboat in the harbour, and of course secured the aid of law enforcement, including the sheriff, meaning that more than 200 vigilantes or citizen deputies under the ostensible authority of Snohomish County Sheriff McRae had collected in order to repel the IWW anarchists. The history of the IWW as anarchists is a whole thing, but regardless, the union has never described itself that way, despite generally being considered anarchist by most who knew about them, and even many members. As the boat drew into the dock and someone on board threw a line over bollard, McRae stepped forward and called out, "Boys, who is your leader?" The IWW men laughed and jeered, replying, "We're all leaders," and they started to swing out their gangplank to disembark. McRae drew his pistol and told them he was sheriff and he was enforcing the law, which was that they could not land there. There was a silence, and then one man came up to the front and yelled, "The hell we can't," and then a single shot, possibly from the sheriff's gun, though this was not proven, was fired, followed by about 10 minutes of intense gunfire. Most of it came from the vigilantes on the dock and the tugboat, but some fire came from the IWW, though the majority of the passengers were unarmed because, well, they weren't expecting to get into a gunfight. Passengers aboard the ship panicked and rushed to the opposite side of the ship, nearly capsizing it and causing the ship's rail to break, ejecting a number of passengers into the water, where some drowned as a result, though how many is not known, or whether persons who'd been shot also went overboard. Just for perspective, over 175 bullets had been fired into the pilot house alone, and the captain of the ship was only able to avoid being shot by ducking behind the ship's safe. At the end of the shootout, two citizen deputies lay dead, with 16 or 20 others wounded, including Sheriff McRae. The two businessman deputies that were shot dead were actually shot in the back by fellow deputies. Their injuries were not caused by IWW gunfire, and it's speculated that the same could be said of many of those injured as well. The IWW officially listed 5 dead with 27 wounded, though it is speculated that as many as 12 IWW members may have been killed, including those drowned. Upon returning to Seattle, 74 IWW members were arrested as a direct result of the Everett massacre. They were taken to Snohomish County Jail in Everett and charged with the murder of two deputies. After a 2-month trial, they were acquitted by a jury on May the 15th, 1917, and shortly thereafter all charges were dropped and they were released from jail. But don't think you were safe as an individual agitator, or that there wasn't necessarily safety in numbers, because oh boy, the bosses didn't like union heroes at all.
I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, "But Joe, you're 10 years dead." "I never died," says he. "I never died," says he.
Mass violence is bad enough, and it's obviously fucking terrifying to imagine the power the bosses held over the government and the large-scale force they were able to command, but often that sort of violence was a last resort. After all, with movements like strikes and labour action, often it was as simple as taking out a couple of key people, snuffing out organisers and agitators to bust a union. These people often get remembered as martyrs, and with good reason. Let's briefly touch on some of their stories right now, but remember that whilst these may be some of the most famous or infamous, they were by no means rare or unusual. The life of a union activist was extremely dangerous, as should be becoming clear.
There is power in a band of working folk. When we stand hand in hand, that's a power that must rule in every land. One industrial union grand.
Joe Hill is a personal hero of mine, and is probably the first name people jump to when they think of union martyrs, or just union heroes in general, and I will absolutely be dedicating at least one very detailed video about his life and legacy, and possibly a separate one entirely about his death in future, but for now I'll just give you the barest minimum details in order to get the point across. Joe Hill was a hero of the union movement during life, being the author of many of the most iconic quotes, political cartoons, and songs of the time, speaking passionately at strikes and picket lines all over the US, inspiring countless people to join the cause and fight for their rights. He was frequently victimized and targeted by the authorities during his time with the IWW. In June 1913, for example, he was arrested for vagrancy during a dock workers' strike in California and put in jail for 30 days. The real reason for the incarceration, according to Hill, was that he was a little too active to suit the chief of the burg. So Hill was on the radar of cops and politicians who didn't want to see unions establishing a presence in their towns. He may have been even more worrisome to authorities than other union leaders, since, unlike many others, he could energize the workers and reinforce their solidarity with song, an important talent in a time period where pamphlets and political theory would have been inaccessible to many workers, as illiteracy was at a relative high at the time. In his own words, "A pamphlet, no matter how good, is never read more than once, but a song is learned by heart and repeated over and over. And I maintain that if a person can put a few common sense facts into a song and dress them up in a cloak of humour, he will succeed in reaching a great number of workers who are too unintelligent or too indifferent to read." In 1914, he was framed for murder and sentenced to death. There's a lot of detail here that I'll definitely cover at a future date, but for now the barest details are as follows. Hill showed up to a doctor's office with a gunshot wound that he refused to explain on the same night as a former police officer and current grocery store owner and his son were shot, but not before apparently inflicting a similar wound upon one of their assailants. The doctor suggested to the authorities that his patient could have been the killer and Hill was arrested. However, unsurprisingly, it soon became clear that the state was pretty much just using this as an excuse to get rid of a man who was deemed extremely dangerous to many of the people in power at the time, as the evidence was basically non-existent. The part of the city the incident occurred in was known for high gun crime, and in fact several other murders were committed by other assailants that same night in the surrounding areas, and the lawyers assigned to Hill were seemingly deliberately undermining their own case. This was hardly surprising, given that Utah Governor William Spry, who oversaw much of these proceedings, had been elected to office on a platform that stated he would sweep out lawless elements, whether they be corrupt businessmen or IWW agitators. Joe Hill was tied to a chair and executed by a firing squad on November 19, 1915 at Utah's Sugar House Prison. When Deputy Shetler, who led the firing squad, called out the sequence of commands preparatory to firing, ready, aim, Hill shouted, "Fire! Go on and fire!" effectively giving the order for his own execution. Just prior to his execution, Hill had written to Bill Haywood, an IWW leader, in a note smuggled out by bribing a guard, saying, "Goodbye, Bill. I die like a true blue rebel. Don't waste any time in mourning. Organize. Could you arrange to have my body hauled to the state line to be buried? I don't want to be found dead in Utah." With his final words having been recorded by Hunter S. Thompson as "Don't mourn, organize," a slogan that has been in use by leftist movements across the globe ever since. We'll come back to Joe Hill in a lot more detail soon, but for now, his story is an example of the lengths to which those in power would go to in order to rid themselves of a dangerous, disruptive, radical figure, and how little the law and due process often meant to them when it came to silencing someone who inspired a working people to fight back and demand better. Speaking of which,
there is power in a band of working folk. When we stand hand in hand, that's a power that must rule in every land. One industrial union grand.
Frank Little was a union organizer, free speech activist, and member of the IWW's General Executive Board. He was instrumental in organizing strikes across the country in various industries, including lumberjacks, metal miners, migrant farm workers, dock workers, and oil field workers. He was also an enthusiastic anti-war agitator, joining a number of pacifists, describing the First World War as a rich man's war and a poor man's fight, and the soldiers fighting it as Uncle Sam's scabs in uniform. In 1917, whilst attempting to help dock workers organized a strike for better conditions and wages, he was kidnapped, beaten, and literally fucking lynched. The details are pretty brutal. Little was tied to a car's rear bumper and dragged over the granite blocks of the street, resulting in photographs of his body showing that his kneecaps had possibly been scraped off. He was then taken to Milwaukee Bridge at the end of town, where he was hanged from a railroad trestle. The coroner found that Little died of asphyxiation. It was also found that his skull had been fractured by a blow to the back of the head caused by a rifle or gun butt. A note with the words "first and last warning" was pinned to his thigh, referring to earlier vigilantes giving people three warnings to leave town. The note also included the numbers 3777, a sign of vigilantes active in the 19th century in Virginia City, Montana, some people thought referred to grave measurements, and the initials of other union leaders suggesting they were next to be killed. No one was ever caught or prosecuted for the murder, though it's pretty clear who was ultimately responsible, as everyone speculated to have been involved had at least some connections to the Anaconda Mining Company, and interestingly, Ed Morrissey, who had been Butte's chief of detectives at the time of the murder, had taken a 20-day leave of absence on the day following the killing. It was alleged at the trial brought by the IWW that Morrissey had scratches on his face at the time, which was consistent with the fact that, according to the autopsy, Little had tried to fight off his assailants and, as a result, had someone's skin under his fingernails, which was never able to be tested, obviously because DNA wasn't to be invented for decades to come. And all because some mining dock workers wanted better working conditions and higher pay.
There is power in a band of working folk. When we stand hand in hand, that's a
must rule in every land. One industrial union grand.
Nicola Sacco and Bartolomeo Vanzetti were Italian immigrant anarchists who were accused of murdering two people during an armed robbery in 1920. 7 years later, they were executed by electric chair at Charleston State Prison. Just as with the trial of Joe Hill, the whole process was absolutely fucked from the start. Anti-Italianism, anti-immigrant and anti-anarchist bias were suspected as having heavily influenced the verdict, including comments from various court officials, but especially the judge, who was, shall we say, not a fan of Italians or anarchists, and openly boasted about deliberately subverting the trial, having been reported saying, variously, "I'll show them that no long-haired anarchist from California can run this court. You wait till I give my charge to the jury. I'll show them. Did you see what I did with those anarchistic bastards the other day? I guess that'll hold them for a while. Let them go and see now what they can get out of the Supreme Court," calling defendants Bolsheviki and saying that he would get them good and proper. So, you know, a completely unbiased and fair process, and exactly the sort of situation you want when two possibly innocent men are accused of a serious crime, the result of a guilty verdict being execution by electric chair. A series of appeals followed in which it was revealed that not only was there significantly suspicious evidence, like recanted testimony, conflicting ballistics evidence, a prejudicial pretrial statement by the jury foreman, and a confession by an alleged participant in the robbery, all appeals were denied by trial Judge Webster Thayer, and also later denied by the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court. It has actually been speculated that it is actually possible that one or both did actually commit the crime, but again, the evidence was simply not there, and to convict either or both on the flimsy evidence that did exist is troubling at best. But hey, I guess at least this sort of brutality and mistreatment is behind us, eh? I mean, sure, this seems pretty bad, but history often is, and when was the last time something like this happened in the Western world? Apart from the times it did, I mean.
When the Union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no power greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet what force on earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one? But the Union makes us strong. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever.
We often see this violence as a part of the past, a sad part of history, but ultimately one thing that we no longer have to deal with, and that's generally true in the West, excluding a couple of outlying extreme examples like Standing Rock, as mentioned earlier. But the reason for this is that as Western democracies implemented stronger regulations and restrictions on working conditions and acceptable standards for workers, more and more corporations responded by simply moving their operations overseas, where they'd be more able to abuse workers in less highly regulated places in the third world. The conditions endured by workers in places like Colombia and Bangladesh nowadays are extremely similar to those suffered by European and American workers just 100 years ago. From the conditions to the violence, meaning that these abuses didn't ever stop, they just moved elsewhere, out of sight of the average Western consumer and therefore out of mind, as I will now demonstrate.
I can hold your gun where I'm from in third world, sign to many places, but I'm third world born. Gorillas hit and run where I'm from in third world, sign. You polluted everything and now the third world's gone.
This story is often misreported as Coca-Cola murders trade unionists, and from a certain perspective, that's not necessarily untrue, but it's important to view the situation in Colombia as a systemic issue rather than just a story of a single evil American corporation, because it's not just one evil American corporation engaging in heinous acts of oppression and violence. It's lots of them. That being said, the fight against Coca-Cola has significant symbolic meaning as it exemplifies the transnational corporations which receive support and protection from Colombia's neoliberal government, and often its transgressions are overlooked due to the economic boost it offers. However, it must be acknowledged that there have been 14 members of Sinaltronal, that's the labor union representing Coca-Cola workers since 1990, which is not insignificant, and whilst they represent a tiny fraction of the 2,800 murders of Colombian unionists occurring between 1984 and 2011, and the literally tens of thousands of other social movements, activists, and protesters having met violent deaths, it cannot be overlooked that these specific murders are occurring, allegedly, under the direction of the company that likes to put across this wholesome image. I mean, they're the Christmas advert people, right? Christmas doesn't start till the Coca-Cola ad comes on TV. Santa wouldn't endorse the murder of 14 union activists, I'm sure. Most of the blame for the violence is usually placed on the shoulders of Colombia's paramilitary forces, though it's speculated that they aren't working simply for themselves. There are strong ties between the United Self-Defense Forces of Colombia, or AUC, Colombia's biggest paramilitary group, and the Colombian military. The AUC is also quietly backed by elements of the business and economic elite. Oh, and fun fact, according to the union leaders, in 1996, a right-wing paramilitary squad of the AUC showed up at the gate of the coke bottling plant in Carepa, murdered a member of the union's executive board, and then an hour after he was assassinated, paramilitary forces attempted to kidnap another leader of the union at his home, and later that same day broke into the union's offices, destroyed the equipment there, and burned down the entire building, destroying all the union's records. The next day, the heavily armed group went inside the bottling plant, called the workers together, and gave them until 4 p.m. to resign from the union under not-so-subtle threats of violence. Not surprisingly, union members resigned en masse. A number of workers also quit their jobs outright, undoubtedly fearing that they would be killed simply for showing up. Sound familiar?
I can hold your gun where I'm from, a third world sign to many places, but I'm third world born. Gorillas hit and run where I'm from, a third world sign. You polluted everything and now the third world's gone.
In 2012, the Marikana Platinum Mine, operated by Lonmin in Kanning, near Rustenburg, South Africa, 3,000 workers walked off the job on the 10th of August after Lonmin failed to meet to negotiate with union representatives. Between 12th and the 14th of August, approximately 9 people were killed in the area around Marikana. There are conflicting reports on who killed who, however, at least 4 miners, 2 police officers and 2 security guards are claimed to have been killed during this time. Before the shooting, South African police captain Dennis Adreo told journalists, "We have tried over a number of days to negotiate with the leaders and with the gathering here at the mine. Our objective is to get people to surrender their weapons and to disperse peacefully." However, submissions to the subsequent Farlam Commission dispute this, accusing police of failing to negotiate with strikers and participating in revenge killing. It has been said that the former union Cyril Ramaphosa, who is currently the president of South Africa from his position on the board in Lonmin, could have argued for negotiation, even for a better deal for the workers. Instead, as a chain of emails released to the subsequent inquiry disclosed, he argued for the police to move in. In a message to fellow directors, he wrote, "The terrible events that have unfolded cannot be described as a labour dispute. They are plainly dastardly criminal and must be characterised as such. There needs to be concomitant action to address this situation." He has since apologised, but this incident continues to stain his political reputation. The Association of Mine Workers and Construction Unions, Joseph Matundwa, said that the protests were in response to poor pay. "As long as bosses and senior management are getting fat checks, that's good for them, and these workers are subjected to poverty for life. After 18 years of democracy, the mine worker is still earning 3,000 South African rand, approximately $360, under these harsh conditions underground." On the afternoon of the 16th of August, members of a contingent of the South African Police Service from an elite special unit opened fire with assault rifles on a group of strikers, killing 34 miners and wounding, at a low estimate, 78. The incident was the single most lethal use of force by South African security forces against civilians since the end of apartheid in 1995. Footage from several different angles shows that the police were pushing the strikers into a small area. Groups of strikers begin singing struggle songs and marched along police lines. The police fired tear gas and rubber bullets into these groups. Again, remind you of anything? Al Jazeera reported that the strikers had been forced by police and armoured vehicles with water cannons into an area surrounded by razor wire, at which point the shooting began, from which there was, of course, no escape, and as was presumably the intention of the assailants. Greg Marinovich examined the scene and found that the majority of victims were shot 300 metres from police lines where the main charge took place. He claims that some of the victims appear to have been shot at close range or crushed by police vehicles. Some victims were shot in a koppie, where they were cornered and could easily have been peacefully, or at least non-lethally, arrested. Due to local geography, they must have been shot at close range. Few bullets were found in the surrounding area, suggesting that they did not die in a hail of bullet. Marinovich concludes that it is becoming clear to this reporter that heavily armed police hunted down and killed the miners in cold blood. Now, don't get me wrong, there is significant evidence that the violence here was at least partially on both sides, and the striking workers absolutely did engage in violence against the police, the security forces, and even apparently at one point their own union leaders, but the point here is not that they were completely blameless and or innocent, but that the response was unnecessarily disproportionate, and well, that the majority of the violence and the resources were deployed by the state and the capitalists working together against the workers, many of whom were not in fact violent in any way and just wanted better working conditions and higher pay.
I can hold your gun where I'm from, a third world sign to many places, but I'm third world born. Gorillas hit and run where I'm from, a third world sign. You polluted everything and now the third world's gone.
This one's pretty well publicized, but in case you weren't aware, after safety legislation and decent wage reforms were introduced in the Western world, many garment manufacturers began to look elsewhere for workers they could exploit, and unsurprisingly, the conditions in these factories are frankly disgusting. For example, in April 2013, a garment factory collapsed, killing 1,100 garment workers and injuring many others, despite the fact that it was obvious and had been reported to bosses that it was unsafe to continue to keep it running without repairing the damaged infrastructure. These are places that desperately need unions but struggle to build them. Only about 10% of Bangladesh's more than 4,500 garment factories have registered unions. While many factory workers have tried to form unions, government authorities have frequently rejected applications, and Bangladesh labour laws and procedures pose formidable barriers to founding and operating a union, and without legal recognition, strike action, for example, is seen as a crime. The law requires an unreasonably high 30% of workers in a factory to agree to form a union and mandates excessive registration procedures. The government has vaguely defined powers to cancel a union's registration. Factories also threaten and attack unions and their members with impunity. Human Rights Watch, for example, has documented cases of physical assault, intimidation, and threats, such as threats of sexual violence against women workers seeking to form unions, dismissal of union leaders, and false criminal complaints by factory officials or their associates against union-affiliated garment workers. The Bangladesh authorities have failed to hold factory officials accountable for the crimes committed during union-busting efforts, despite the fact that since 2013, the Solidarity Center has documented more than 100 cases in which factory officials or hired thugs have beaten or threatened workers, intimidated their families, filed false criminal charges against workers, or fired them for union activity. Union martyrs are still being made, and the union burying grounds are still growing, just not in the West, at least not as obviously, but out of sight, out of mind, I suppose.
When the union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no power greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet what force on earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one? But the union makes us strong. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. Solidarity forever. For the union makes us strong.
I hope this was informative and provided sufficient context as to the conditions of the average worker around the time of the labour rights movement. I'll probably be referring back to this video in future whenever I need to provide context, which is primarily why it exists, and hopefully why it'll be the closest I'll get to a full-on dry history lecture. I thought it would be best to condense all the dry, heavy, information-dense stuff into one video rather than sprinkling it throughout other videos, potentially detracting from them. Having said that, I did actually really enjoy writing and researching this topic, and I think it's important to set the scene, so to speak. You probably noticed as I was going through the history, but I wholeheartedly believe that it's important to remember the way those in power treated those without in the past, so we can recognise and resist it in the future, and especially the present, as the concept of the company town is making a comeback, and the media is falling over itself to praise Amazon for bringing back long outdated concepts like that. Remember our martyrs. Remember those who laid down their lives to fight for and protect the rights we take for granted today, because if we don't, we are doomed to lose them. Remember what the bosses and capitalists did before the workers of the past were able to demand better conditions, and above all, look at the places in the world right now where workers are not able to. That fate is what awaits us should those with the capital be able to set their own rules and gain more power and autonomy. When left to their own devices, when not impeded by reforms and regulations, corporations will show you what they would do if they could get away with it, just as they did in the past and they currently do in the third world. This is, in my opinion, the ultimate argument against those pro-business, anti-regulation, small government, big capitalist types, who seem to believe that capitalists are inherently benevolent and who, were there no dastardly regulations, would be only too happy to act against their interests and reject the incentives baked into our economic system in favour of working for the greater good somehow. You know that old adage, when someone shows you who they are, believe them? Yeah, that applies here too, I think.
I'm standing there as big as life and smiling with his eyes. Says Joe, what they forgot to kill, went on to organise.